really good peanuts. It's so good. They're very, very good. Mm. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to the man who make these famous peanuts because they're so good. Jay, ladies and gentlemen, here is Jay Fiandella here at JJ's in Santa Monica, California. Jay, can you tell me something about these nice peanuts and how you do them and so forth?
You eat eight peanuts is equal to protein, and eight peanuts is equal to eating one whole steak. So, Slim, they're good for you.
But now we'd like to find out another one thing, Jay. You have a secret formula of preparing them with the salt and the thing. Like, your secret is it?
Well, these people ask me how you get the salt.
Exactly.
Well, they put it in their pablum and their babies. No, I'm being funny. But the shell of the peanut is porous, and they soak them in a salt brine, and they roast them. And through osmosis, the salt goes from the top of the shell in and crusts the peanut on the inside. So that's why that's how we get them salted.
You. The peanut and the parade. Now, that's what I want to find out. Now, what is the most interesting thing about a peanut?
I have an astronaut. I have a peanut that went to the moon, ladies and gentlemen. Believe that.
Will you repeat that, please?
I have the world's only astronaut. When I opened in 1959, NASA had headquarters right down the street, so all the astronauts used to come here. Shepard, Sherrod, Conrad, Glenn, any of them used to hang out here. And one night I'm sitting with Alan Shepard. Well, let me, I don't want to interrupt my story, but let me get the world's famous astronaut, Moon Goober. We can't get him separated. I don't want to get him mixed up, but drop it in that one.
No.
This, ladies and gentlemen, I dropped it, is a peanut that went to the moon and back. Alan Shepard, the astronaut, on Apollo 14, took this peanut to the moon. We're having dinner with a whole bunch of people, and he swore me to secrecy. He said, I'm going to take a golf ball and a golf club to the moon. I'm going to hit the world's longest golf shot. So I said, wow. There was a basket of peanuts on the table, so I grabbed a peanut, this particular peanut, and I said, listen, take a peanut to the moon for me. So he said, sure, and he stuck it in his pocket. He went overseas. We all followed his career to the moon. And then back, and about a month later, he called me. He said, Fiandella, and I was called. Those Navy admirals always call you by your last name. He said, Fiandella, I got your peanut. I said, wow, you mean you took it to the moon? He said, yeah. One night I introduced Julie Andrews and Blake Edwards to Alan Shepard, and she said, Alan, what was your biggest thrill? He said, when I was on the moon and I held my thumb, my forefinger up, and there was a world in between. That was my greatest thrill, being on the moon.
That was the size of the world,
yep,
from the moon.
The size of the peanut.
But I want to tell you one thing. I would like to play a song dedicated to that peanut. Would that be okay?
Oh, I love it. You've been playing here for 30 years, pal. Well, I deem it a pleasure to hear you.
Will that be all right?
I love it.
Okay.
I love it. I know my people love it.
Alice, are you here? Where's Alice? Here you go, peanut, for you. Somewhere there's music, moon, stars, Pluto, Jupiter, Mars, Venus, Saturn, Mercury. Flying through the skies, right before your eyes. Then you realize, say, the moon, moon. Everybody's wondering how high the moon. You know, you were there. Oh, we're on top of the moon. Lucky little peanut to take a moon flight. And they're wondering, oh, how high the moon. The moon, peanut, 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 peanut. You a moon nut. A moon, peanut. Oh, you're an astronaut. You heard an astronaut, 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 astronaut. Google what you call the name, Google something.
Astronaut, Google.
Googly, googly. Don't let that peanut get tangled up with those others.
Oh, no.
This one goes in the safe. In the bank, you're hid away. In the safe, you're a very famous peanut. I'd like to have you make some peanut butter with you. Be the most expensive peanut butter ever was made. Billions of people would love to see you, but it's over here, Shay J's in Santa Monica. And Jay Fiandella have it, the only peanut
pebbles on the moon. The first, the only peanut was on the moon. That peanut, the size of the world. Hey, man, now that's really trapping in it. And everybody wondering how high the moon. Do you know you were there. How high the moon.
Robertson, I wish to congratulate you upon the splendid conception of this time capsule, the initiative, and the and its splendid execution. I'm sure that you're leaving a message to posterity 5,000 years hence, which they will find interesting and understand perhaps something of our present civilization.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to tell you about this time capsule. In 1938, I was here, and it was something to see. Everybody was all around. It had all the different washing machines and everything, radios and television, everything you could think of there. And they had those pulleys that were going down. It's about 30 feet down here. And here's the diameter of it across here. That's the size of it. And it was something to see. I mean, it was unbelievable what they were putting in there.
Into the tube are placed articles that will tell the story of our times. Microfilm reproduction of motion pictures, books, newspaper articles. And examples of things we use, textiles, seeds, tools. The glass tube is put into a time capsule, time resisting, made of a special alloy to last 5,000 years. And then they lower it into a casing 50 feet below the Westinghouse building at the New York World's Fair. The idea is that 5,000 years from now, scientists will take out the time capsule and find out about us.
When it came to music, they had all the really heavy people in there. And guess what? They got something else in there, too. See, now it's, they got 4,950 more years to go, and that will be something. When they open it up, it's going to be something, because I want to say, Flatfoot Fuji with the fly, fly. Flatfoot Fuji with the fly, fly. Flatfoot Fuji with the fly, fly. Flat for Fluji may have ended up a piece of history, but it took me over a year to get anybody to listen to it. I got to know every inch of Broadway, walking up and down, trying to get the publisher to listen to my songs. Then Benny Goodman heard Flat Foot Fluji, and he played it on the radio, and then everybody wanted it. Flatfoot Fluji became a hit all over the world. My partner Slam and I were an overnight sensation. We're on our way to Hollywood, the home of the stars.
Coming on. One, two, keep that rhythm heat. One more rhythm like that and I'll be gone. Oh man, don't stop now, we jump it.
Hey, that was some movie. Hell's a Poppin'. Had C.P. Johnson, Rick Stewart was with Duke Ellington's orchestra, and Slam Stewart, my partner. We had some nice fun doing that. And also the Kangaroos, they were wild dancing. The people knew about us in England. Here's a thing called rhythm, and the price was 1 shilling. But I like this part in you say, shortcut to sanity. Now that sounds really good for me.
Vengan acá todos. Vengan a ver esa palomita que me encontré en su nido.
Está echadita.
Oiga, señor, we are federales, you know, the mountain police.
If you're the police, where are your badges?
Badges? We ain't got no badges. We don't need no badges. I don't have to show you any stinking badges.
Okay, okay, that's good, that's great. Hey, but listen, this is the time where we're going to induct Slim Gaillard into the Majubers with full honors and a 10 purple mushroom salute. Now, Slim, I don't want to see any smiling on your face. I want you to follow directions carefully and do as I say. All right? Raise your left hand. That's right. No smiling. I can tell when you're about to smile. Now, you got your left hand up. You repeat after me. We do this in two parts. I don't got to show you.
I don't got to show you.
That's good. No stinking badges.
No stinking badges.
All right, that's it. Now, if anybody asks to see your badge, you just tell them, I don't got to show you. No stinking badges.
That's my very good friend, Al Jazbo Collins. He's going to tell you about that famous hat he's wearing.
First of all, it turns you immediately into a troll or a hobbit, see? Like you could go down into Tolkien's ring and stay there for the rest of the day. But also, you notice it comes to a point, and it's a pyramid. And there's a lot of stuff going on inside this hat. Pyramid power.
Yeah, well,
and
yeah,
the minute you put this thing on, you start getting ideas from out of town. I mean, long distance is local with this hat.
Oh, is that right? Al has a TV show every week in New York, and when I got the call, I just had to go. In fact, anything goes on Al's show, and it all goes out live.
The sun comes shining through, but when you're crying, you bring on the rain. Stop your crying, babe. Be happy again. Keep on smiling. Say you're smiling. The whole world smiles with you.
He knows how many viewers he's got. In fact, he knows each one by name. Al, he doesn't care. He's got all the latest technology, though.
Let's give a little attention to the plant. We better feed the plant a little bit before we go any further, because that's one of the rituals that we have to do.
Yeah. There he is, my man. Come right on in, come right on in.
And I was right in the middle of my worst throes of being affected by Slim Gaillard's type of talk and the jive talk that he came down with Vado Rooney and Laco Michouet and singing about things on Armenian menus like he did with Yaprak Harisi and all that stuff. And I had really changed over. A lot of people called me. They want to know if I was really Slim or not. And, well, of course, you know, they knew I wasn't, but... We just had an absolute ball at that time.
Let's take a look into the wok and see what the doctor is mixing up for us tonight.
We have
doctor,
a
doctor. You want to address the multitudes?
Yeah, we have a Rooney Vauti McNeerissimo here.
What's that?
We have a Rooney Vauti McNeerissimo.
That's right.
Oh, in honor of Slim.
Yeah, that's
it
a good
is dish. Mock French fried bee's knees with hippopotamus lips juice sauce. And just for you, Slim, we have a recipe.
Here we hit hippopotamus lips juice.
Would he like that?
Dr. Wok. This is the way you prepare avocado seed soup. You get an avocado, put a nail in it and a string on it, then you nail it to the ceiling and let it vault for a while.
Now, let me harken back to those old heritage days.
Okay.
Where did you originally come from? You know, there's a lot of mystery involved in it. A lot of people thought you came from some other place. And I said, no, you came from another place.
I come. Everybody say I come from Detroit.
From Detroit,
everybody
yeah.
Everybody say that because I was born in a little island down below Florida. This little island is a very nice little island. Was. Now, it was Santa Clara, Cuba.
In Cuba, Santa Clara, Cuba.
Yeah, very, very nice. And it's up on the hill. And tonight, we had a special celebration with some of the friends from Santa Clara. I left the island and started sailing on big boats. One habit I had was never look back. Because when I look back, I want to go back to her. Never thought I would never see her again. I said, I'll be back for sure. But guess what? It never happened. Now it's all come down on my mind. She's sinking in my memories.
Yeah, do one of those commercials, Slim, like
okay.
You used to do. Listen to this.
Para gusun to kayila papala kasad la gayon to sukut the 5171 Broadway kusun to kayila papala kasad la kayon so to coins to get $10 down kugin sa kayila la kasun kayila papala kasin lele kayo to 18 months to pay kun yun so kayila papa ala sa the Robert Hall bu kun yun sa kayila la sin ko pala tenga oh the crab house ubi kayila so kayila papa is the this is the kamir kamito kida ya
now well You know, Slim, I told you, Slim speaks about 11 languages.
That's all.
Japanese, too, right?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Say something.
You know what it means?
No.
Hey, man.
What if you should say, no tengo que enseñarle ningunas chapas malditas? What would that mean?
In English, it would mean, I don't got to show you no steak and bodges.
That's right. That's right. Hey, we got that.
And you know, you remember I was working with Slam Stewart?
Yes, that's right. How did you meet Slam, anyhow?
Well, I was in New York, this city here, up 135th Street, and there was a place called the Big Apple, down in the basement.
Yes.
And I walked by there, and the booking agent for amateur show for Major Bowles asked me, he says, would you be able to do a show with this band downstairs? He played good bass. And I said, okay, that's all right. The agent gave us all the same amount of funds, and I told him, I said, he said, yes, I will. So we come down to the CBS, another television station. It was radio then.
Yeah.
And we go down to the station. This is, we'd had to do an audition, though. It was an amateur show, but we had to audition for
it. For Major Bowles.
Oh, listen, we had to go to Third Degree to get on there.
Yeah.
So, but they says, okay, we'll have you on. So then we do you have a name? I say, my name is Slim Gaillard. And what's your name? He said, well, I don't have a name. He said, well, I'll make you Slam, Slim and Slam. Now, here's my buddy over here, Slam Stewart. He had a unique style of playing. He used to bow and sing the same. He had a perfect pitch. He could sing any note that he played on that bass, and they made a big hit with him. Became a team, Slim and Slam. Well, it must be that I don't know where. Oh,
something. My first song. Flatfoot Fluji with the Floy Floy, recorded and copyrighted 1938, January 7th. And then later when I wrote another song, now this song, it says January 7th, 1938, and the copyright Library of Congress, United States of America, registered, the composer, Bully Slim Gaillard, the title, Tutti Frutti. My song.
Wah bam loo mam la bam bam tutti frutti. Oh rude. 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 Oh wah bam loo mam la bam bam. I got a girl.
Why don't he sing his own song?
Well, sometimes I would get in my little attitude that I didn't want to go on last. Like when I worked with Jerry Lee Lewis, I wouldn't want to go on last. Because he would always mess with the audience, and he would go out there and hit somebody, want to fight. And by the time you get on, everybody would be mad, you know? And I said, let me go on first. And Jerry Lee Lewis said, no! If he go on first, I am not going on. And so Chuck Berry didn't like to follow me either. No, I have never met an entertainer like that because...
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time that you hear the original Tutti Frutti.
Ours is an awe-inspiring privilege. We shall be the first, mark you well, the very first, to hear Tutti Frutti on the air. Brace yourselves and listen to Tutti Frutti.
Vanilla, I don't like chocolate. Give me some of that good Tutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. For Tutti Frutti, Tutti Frutti, Tutti Frutti, Tutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. Get yourself a cutie. Tutti Tutti Frutti now. Tutti Frutti with best of mouth. Don't like vanilla now. The chocolate will do. But for me, let me tell you. Bring me some of that good Tutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. Tutti Frutti Frutti. The fruit, 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 the fruit,
order to report for induction the President of the United States to Bully Gaillard. Greetings. Having submitted yourself to a local board composed of your neighbors, and for the purpose of determining your availability for training and the service in the armed forces of the United States, you are hereby notified that you have now been selected for training.
A date which will live in infamy.
You had a good home and you left. You're right. You had a good home and you left. You're right. You had a good home and you left. You're right. Left, right, left, right. Trip, but, left, but, oh.
United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
When I first was drafted in the service, I had been studying code. And after I learned the code, when I come into the service, I had 130 IQ, and I qualified to go to officers' training school. And my choice qualified to make it as a pilot. I had to have X amount of training, 3 months actually. 1,700 hours I put in training in planes. And I was trained for medium bombers.
Hey, you had a good home and you left. You're right, you had a good home and you left. You left, right, left, right. You're right, you left. You're right, you left. You're left, right, up. Had a good home and you left. You're right, you had a good home and you left. You're right, you had a good home and you left. You're right, you had a good home and you left.
We were the first black medium bomber group to touch medium bomber plane. They all was white always. So we go to Texas and they had an all-white group training there. And when we come to the base there in Shipperfield, Texas, we all, as I say, I was in 930's air group. And when we come there, they all look and they laugh. The people in Texas say, ha, 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 look at those black guys. They're not going to make it through this training. We come out with 90 and 95, and the general come down and gave us a nice big welcome. And they all were laughing before, but their laugh was stopped when we come through in one day. Won all the honors. Then,
and where were you sent to serve?
What is it?
Where did you serve?
South Pacific. New Georgia, the Fijis, New Guinea, the Hebrides, New Caledonia. My job was to just fly the plane, nothing to do with bombs, just take the plane on flight there, had the tail gunner, had the bombardier, you had the nose, everybody was all on their jobs and all that, to take the plane there wherever it is.
So the bombardier would drop the bombs according to his instructions, right. And you would just fly the plane?
I just fly the plane, and they follow my course, and they took instructions from the commander. Bridges, air bases, factories, train stations, and airports. That was the main target. But airports was the toughest one because we lost lots of planes that day. Because they were camouflaged so well until you didn't even know it was an airport. You know, just, those planes that they had were coming after so fast. And B-25 and 26, the 26 you could maneuver. For the 25 you couldn't maneuver, you just fly straight ahead. 26 could move. They call it maneuvering coffin.
How did you feel before going on a mission? Were you afraid?
Well, you just became immune to going. You just take a prayer and go.
Slim, tell me how you felt when you heard the sound of those engines.
Well, it was a very sad sound because you didn't know what's in ahead of you, what's down below, what's coming on top of you. You never knew anything. It's a very sad sound. Make you very weepy.
Things.
I always felt that way. But it's always felt that they were dropping unnecessary things because everybody wondered what they were dropping them for. And I said, what are we flying around here dropping bombs on things and people? We shouldn't be doing that. But you had orders. You're either going to be court-martialed, they put you in. So you had to do the best of it. Your mission.
Did other pilots feel like that too?
Quite a few. Yeah. Some was angry because they were forced to do it and they didn't mind it. Some But there was some sad and some wouldn't take a flight sometime. They put him in the brig, put him inside, locked him up, and reduced him. You had to be at least a second lieutenant, which I made it up, Mike, because I was a captain. And they asked me if I wanted to come back in the service before I get discharged, we'll make you a major. I said, thank you very much, but no thank you. Mm. And I come on out.
So you were entitled to leave because you'd been wounded?
I had a disability. Mm. I had about, when I got discharged, I had about 75% disability when I first got it. And then going to the Veterans Hospital for treatment and things on and on, and I got down about 50, then 25, and down to, then they released me after I got around to about 10%. Mm. And then I got discharged, and then now consider me as 100%. But the weather sometimes, you feel the shrapnel in your arm and in your leg, and it hurts you when you walk sometimes.
Some of it's still there?
Yeah, still there. It stays there.
Mm. When you say you broke down, how
that means a nervous breakdown. Your knowledge go away. Mm. We had quite a few. I had a general, was with a 2-star general. We were in the same hospital together. And when you break down, they put you in the top floor, which is security. You can't leave. You're in the bars. And then they bring you down another floor if you're getting better. And then you bring you down another floor and you get close to get out. Sound of the planes flying over, and I felt like this about the war. I hated it. Horrible thought, war. Thank you.
one night we suddenly went mad together again. We went to see Slim Gaillard in a little Frisco nightclub. Slim Gaillard is a tall, thin Negro with big, sad eyes who's always saying,
"Oh, Rooney."
In Frisco, great, eager crowds of young semi-intellectuals sat at his feet and listened to him on the piano, guitar, and bongo drums. When he gets warmed up and he takes off his shirt and undershirt and really goes, he doesn't say anything that comes into his head. He'll sing Cement Mixer, Putty Putty. He'll suddenly slow down the beat and brood over the bongos with fingertips barely tapping the skin as everybody leans forward breathlessly to hear. You think he'll do this for a minute or so, but he goes right on for as long as an hour, making an imperceptible little noise at the tips of his fingernails, smaller and smaller all the time till you can't hear it anymore. And signs of traffic come in the open door. Then he slowly gets up, very, very slowly.
O'Rooney, McVouty, O'Schooly Reeny Moe. How's the boys doing with the girls in the front row? Urinimo. Ovalti.
He keeps this up for 15 minutes, his voice getting softer and softer till you can't hear. His great sad eyes scan the audience. Dean stands in the back saying, "God, yes," and clasping his hands in prayer and sweating. Sal, Slim knows time. He knows time.
Was he?
As we know by now, that was from On the Road. Could you tell me a bit about when you first met Kerouac?
Well, the first time, Van, that I met Jack Kerouac was in the safe when in San Francisco. He used to come in. Frankly, well, it was 7 days of a week, so he was in there 8 days a week. And he was my very close friend. We used to have dinner together. I did a lot of cooking and things for him. He was a very super friend. You know that I played a number called Arabian Boogie, but
yeah,
that was a different end.
Different
rhythm, what was the other one? Tip Light.
Tip Light, that was a B-side.
Yeah, right. The A-side was Arabian Boogie.
Yeah.
But you remember that one.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you one thing about Jack Kerouac. Everybody don't really understand that he was a really deep into music and a very good listener. Plus, he used to value all of the nice friends from Haight-Ashbury because the friends on Haight-Ashbury used to make all of the equipment, everything that they sold. They were very artistic.
The part where he describes where you're playing the bongos and you go into this slow time, what was that?
Yeah, that was real authentic Cuban rhythm. That's my little island that I came from, and I just enjoyed playing, and he enjoyed the music, and the customers used to come in and sit down and enjoy themselves. And I just kept the rhythm going. It was great fun. You never heard me play those kind of rhythms before, did you?
No, not that one.
Babaloo. Babaloo, 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 ah, yeah. Babaloo, ¿qué tal? Antes yo tenía mucha dificultad. El mundo en la cubo todos le gustó ese corazón. Usted mismo la crista, y tiene mucha dificultad todos ahí, que tú estás ahí allá. Antes, pero todo Cuba. Corazón de Babalú. Chango en la caballo allá, usted, Musi toros. En Cuba tiene mucha dificultad ahorita, mueren de toros, no tiene comida, no tiene nada, no tiene nada ahorita, pero necesito. Mi amigo, toro de toro Cuba, Babalú.
I was explaining, ladies and gentlemen, about Babalú, yeah? Babalu is in Cuba, is the same as Christ in the same direction. They pray and they help everybody. We're over to Botanica Olifi, and this is where you get herbs for everything that you need to help you in every different way. Your life, that's what the Cubans live on, and they all pray to Babalu and Django and the other seven babies. We'll tell you about them later, Olifi.
Dame poco, poco dinero, poco dinero, mucho dinero, porque te no sirve mi gusta mucho dinero. Dame cabo de tabaca, y en el jarrito que tú tienes. Yo quiero, 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 tú estás volando. ¿Entiende? De Santa Clara, Cuba, Orlando. ¡Toros! ¡Toros! Desde cubano y de Santa Clara, que oh, ¡toros cantar! ¡Babalú, vaya! ¡Toros! ¡Babalú cantar! ¡Babalú, vaya! ¡Hey! ¡Babalú cantar! ¡Babalú, vaya! ¡Hey! ¡Babalú! ¡Sí, sí! ¡Babalú! ¡El V! Babalu, Babalu, Django, Babalu, Babalu, Babalu.
Carmen, ¿qué es el nombre?
Mi nombre es Carmen Sandberg. Yo estoy expuesta a esta religión por medio de personas que he salido con. I dated a guy and I became aware of this religion. People worship their own spirits. They take glasses like this and they do una bóveda espiritual. They put seven glasses, they pray at them. And then there are seven African gods that they refer to as the Siete Potencias Africanas. They light candles for them. And the seven African gods are represented by different colors. See, all these things here, the skins, the hairs, the feathers, each god, each one of las siete potencias africanas, they each have certain favorites. They have certain fruits, they have certain skins, and they do special ceremonies. Only people that know this religion can do these things. And there's a lot of people that practice this religion in their hopes. You have to have a godfather that knows what he's doing. I'll let Rogelio explain it in Spanish and we'll translate it.
Okay. Él quiere saber por qué los otros usamos los santos católicos con nuestros santos de religión africana.
Cuando los africanos llegaron a Cuba, tenían su fiesta, tienen su religión, que es la religión africana, la religión lucumista, nuestra religión. Y los españoles llevaban su religión, que es la religión católica. Ellos semejaban la caridad del cobre con Ochún. ¿Por qué? Porque Ochún es la diosa del amor, la caridad del cobre es la diosa del amor. Y para poder hacer la fiesta, los días señalados, semejaron uno con los otros. La Virgen de las Mercedes, que es Obatalá, sí. Nuestra religión es Obatalá, tiene un día señalado. Los españoles para poder hacer su fiesta, los africanos para poder hacer su fiesta, los semejaron cada santo de la religión católica con la religión africana. Por eso la semejanza. Esta no es Obatalá. Obatalá para nosotros es otra cosa, esta es la Virgen de las Mercedes. O sea, nosotros no matamos y hacemos una ceremonia arriba de esta santa. Le ponemos flores y velas. Nosotros hacemos la ceremonia arriba de Obatalá, que es la semejanza de uno con el otro. Esta es la Virgen de Rela, que es Yemayá.
Sí, sí.
O sea, para la iglesia católica esta es la Virgen de Regla, para nosotros es Yemayá, que es la diosa de la profundidad, la diosa del mar, porque viste el manto de azul y porque está arriba del mar. El Lenguá, que es el dios del camino, que es el que abre los caminos, es el día del lunes. O sea, la iglesia católica es el niño de Atocha, porque es niño. O sea, esa es la semejanza que hay entre uno y el otro.
¿Qué
preguntas más tú tienes,
Len? Hace muchas cosas, sabe mucho.
Uh-huh.
Godfather.
Godfather.
¿En inglés?
Padrino.
¿Padrino?
Padrino es el que le hace la ceremonia, o sea, que hace una ceremonia en la cabeza, y es el que lo bautiza. Okay. O sea, tengo mi padrino, o sea, yo soy padrino. Esto es como una cadena que se va introduciendo en una gran familia. Tenemos padrino, tenemos ahijado, tenemos hermano, tenemos tíos, una familia en nuestra religión.
Babalú. Gracias, doctor.
Gracias.
Slim sits down at the piano and hits two notes, two C's, then two more, then one, then two. Suddenly, Slim is playing C-jam blues, and the big booming beat begins, and everybody starts rocking, and Slim looks just as sad as ever, and they blow jazz for half an hour. Takes 2 hours. Slim Gaillard goes and stands against the post, looking sadly over everybody's head. As people come to talk to him, a bourbon is slipped into his hand.
As a bourbon O'Rooney.
Nobody knows where Slim Gaillard is. Dean once had a dream that he was having a baby and his belly was all bloated up blue as he lay on the grass of a California hospital. Under a tree with a group of colored men sat Slim. Dean turned despairing eyes of a mother to him. Slim said,
"Oh, vow to you, Macrooney O'Rini, mo."
My Dean approached him. He approached his God. He thought Slim was God. He shuffled and barred in front of him and asked him to join us. He'll join anybody, but he won't guarantee to be with you there in spirit. Dean got a table, bought drinks, and sat stiffly in front of Slim. Slim dreamed over his head. Every time Slim said,
O'Rooney.
Dean said, yes, I sat there with these two madmen. Nothing happened. To Slim Gaillard, the whole world was just one big.
The whole world is one big round. The world is one big round. O'Rooney to me.